Welcome back to the North American LCS. Now, we want to give a quick shout out to a couple league viewing parties that have been taking place today. First up, in New York, fans have gathered at Playwright Irish Pub to watch the TSM CLG game. And they've saddled up to the counter here in Los Angeles at the Outpost to watch Kobe in Hexavision. Nice, getting a lot of screen time today, Kobe, there. But now let's turn our attention to our next match, Team 8 versus Cloud 9. For Team 8, they have continued to rack up wins, only losing one game in their last five, and that was to TSM. Now, so if the season were to end right now, Team 8 would be sitting pretty with a playoff spot.
Yeah, it's not really pretty if you're the last playoff spot, though. They want to get a little higher up there, and the standing seeding is very important.
Hey, they're a fresh LCS team.
So they're proud of that. Fifth, sixth doesn't really matter.
Sure. They thought they were around like middle of the pack for the most part. And it's a lot about this guy, Cali Trolls. He's been performing well on Champions, and the team is set up around him again, especially with, you know, tanky junglers being a thing again, and Porpoise Pops having a really supportive style now. He's really a facilitator of both Slushy and Cali Trolls, and it's how the team operates best.
Yeah, Cali did come up big in their game yesterday. But man, we have to give credit over to Slushy. This guy, time and again, he has been carrying Team 8 many, many games, whether it's Orianna or LeBlanc. His Orianna play is really interesting too, because not only has most of the other mid laners stopped playing this champion, but he almost always sets up his own shockwaves by leaving the ball on the ground for a while and waiting for people to sort of forget about it. He leaves it there for so long and then makes a minor adjustment right into a shockwave that catches multiple people and sets up his team for a big teamfight win.
And looking at the other side of this matchup is Cloud9. The team had a disappointing performance at IAM Katowice, but if there is a cure for team morale, a win is just what the doctor ordered. And yesterday it was against Team Liquid with a 32-minute game in which they only gave up 3 kills.
Yeah, I mean, while all the talk with the new 5.5 patch has been about tanky junglers, Cloud9 opted for the tanky support with Lemon Nation Nautilus. And it wasn't like they tried to hide it either. These are just things that he tries in solo queue. He plays a lot of them, puts in the work, and, you know, nobody banned it out. And that freed up Cloud9 to go with Meteos on a carry-style jungler.
Full damage. This guy
loves playing full-damage carry-style junglers. We saw it one time before with the Nocturne in the LCS. He does it all the time in solo queue. But it's really Cloud9 where they adapt really well to new patches, but they adapt really well by seeing what everyone else is doing and working against it and bringing some sort of counter to what the general meta is at the time.
Yeah, and Cloud9, they definitely look best when they're innovating and they're trying something new, and it throws their opponents off. It throws them for a loop and gives them that edge. And a teammate on the flip side, they talk about how they want to be that type of innovator, or they want to throw their opponents off. But I think right now they're a little scared of if they whip something out, it's going to throw themselves off. Right? They're still just trying to get into their groove, but I think it's time, with the last 3 games of the regular season on the line, it's time to put your money where your mouth is. Show us some crazy picks. Come on, you guys.
I don't know. I might be on the other side of that argument, saying if things are working right now, you're picking up your wins. Let's make sure we get into playoffs. Then maybe you try something crazy
to move to the playoff spot, man.
It depends on what you deem crazy, right?
Yeah.
I really actually am a fan of the Gragas right now, just because the percentage health damage and the disengage ultimate is so important when almost all the teams are trending towards team fight squads. Yep. Another disengage like Gragas that can split up the enemy team and interrupt the combo, like the Cloud9 combo where they're trying to chain CCs. If you can interrupt that combo, then you can easily pick apart a team fight.
Exactly. I agree. I like the pick. They've played it a few times, so I don't necessarily consider it abnormal for Team 8. maybe for the rest of the teams in the LCS, that would be a somewhat crazy pick. We are going to send it over to the guys at the caster desk for the play-by-play. But on the way, Sneaky says there is definitely a learning curve when his support Lemon Nation picks up a new champion. But making the jump and putting it in practice can give Cloud9 an edge.
Lemon bringing out random picks definitely does affect my playstyle some, because I don't really know what they do at first. I'd say Nautilus was relatively easy, because that's pretty similar to Thresh, except he's super tanky and really easy to hit, so they're going to try and target their CC on them, which actually helps us out a lot. So it's not the hardest thing to adjust to. It probably just takes like a few games at most, but once you do get adjusted, it's definitely worth the pick.
Well, it seems to work with it very well. Elimination has said Sneaky is the favorite of AD carries that he's trained, and he can usually compose himself with whatever Lemon picks.
And those guys have been playing together for a long time.
Real long time. We'll see him play for just a little bit longer here today as we get into the match with a look at the starting lineups. On the blue side, it's going to be teammate. Cali Trolls in the top lane. Porpoise reigning from the jungle. Slushy in mid. Maple Street at AD carry. And Dodo behind him on support.
And on the red side, of course, we have a team trying to move into a tie for second place. Cloud9. Balls in the top lane. Meteos in the jungle. High in mid lane. Sneaky on AD carry. And Lemon Nation on Nautilus? On Vigor?
On Nautilus.
Nobody knows.
But on support. All most less. I'm really hoping that the analyst desk was right. I want to see Zyrene's put your money where your mouth is come to fruition, and I want to see these guys get some zany picks in here.
I'd like to see some zany picks. I mean, teammate has been flirting with the idea of these strange picks. Cloud9, in my opinion, is at their best when they are the first early adapters of a patch because they adapt so quickly to these sorts of things. Cloud9 is typically never a team to play what everyone else is playing and succeed. They look at what people are playing, and they think of the counters to that thing.
Right. It's kind of like playing inside the minds of your opponent, not to what they want. Always the mind games with Cloud9, and out of champion select, it's that guy on your screen. Charlie making the final decisions for them as they go through picks and bans here, taking a bit of the pressure off of the team, as we've heard before.
Taking the blame onto himself.
more or less, onto himself. Alessandra, Nidalee, Zed, and the Morgana gets hit. Cloud9 here for their last ban.
Yeah. Heavy bans onto high, for sure.
Porpoise, that's a good ban there. He's been having a good, good string of games.
Yeah, Porpoise doesn't seem to be the same jungler when he's not on Rek'Sai, but his other fallback is Vi. Mm-hmm. A lot of success on that in the past few games. It's what he was able to defeat Winter Fox with. But whether or not that's worthy of a first pick, this now becomes a very interesting thing because there's so many good junglers up. Sejuani is something that Meteos has actually playing before the patch 5.5, even though Meteos also played Vi yesterday, full damage,
full damage.
Much success.
Punch first, ask questions later.
Or while punching.
Or while punching, that's true. You don't really get an answer out of that one. Cali Trolls, will he give himself a top lane pick here in Gragas or whatever he feels like doing? But it actually is going to be that Sejuani.
They're almost forced to first pick the Sejuani. Not a bad thing. I mean, that's what we were expecting from teammate coming into this week, was a tank jungler with Cali Trolls on a damage dealer in the top lane. Last two games, we have seen that victorious Sejuani. Maybe we'll see three games in a row of it to open up the day. Teammate would definitely like it that way, currently sitting at 8-7 in the standings.
The Freljord is getting a lot of love in this patch and in items. Getting a lot of frozen hearts, too. See what other picks can come in here for Cloud9. Not really seeing much, knowing that Sejuani is going to be effective all game long, rather. Cloud9 has to round out a composition. Get to safety as well as fight around the boar.
Sounds like most people are just delaying here. Cloud9, one of the few teams that actually doesn't tend to hover picks. They will basically instant lock in as soon as they have their minds made up, give the enemy team as little time as possible to react to their picks. It's what every team should do, but do not for some reason, a small optimization. But Maokai being in Balls' hands is really important, actually. It's a champion they're always willing to pick in the first rotation.
Yeah.
And they do it here.
1-0-12 against Liquid yesterday. He had quite a good game. Even if he gets put in the 2v1 situation, he can stay quite safe. Graves may be going over to Maple Street. He hasn't been really the one to be getting the kills, but he has been the benefactor of quite a few good plays from the solo lanes of teammate. And if that's what's working for him, be what they stick with.
Generally solid play from Maple Street all year long.
Yeah.
Not flashy, but he's managed to hold his own in pretty much every lane that he is up against.
Shoes or not.
Gets a comfortable pick. Sometimes you don't slide as much if you're in bare feet.
That's true.
Depending on the surface. I like the Lulu pick as well. This is very similar to the team composition TSM just put together. Just no Zed is possible.
So that could be a three-spot Lulu. Probably not Cali Trolls, could be Slushies. Probably Dodo, so looking at what these guys like to do. High, he actually has quite a few options here. Still has the cannon up, provides good lockdown to the team.
I mean, that may be his only option.
Yeah.
Unless he's been adding
that's true.
unless he's been adding something to his pool recently. Kassadin has been rebuffed up a little bit more on this. It's another champion he's found success with. But honestly, if you look at the last 4 weeks, over a month of play from high,
yeah,
those are the picks he has left, and they're going to wait to the last pick to try and give him a, maybe a counterpick opportunity.
Well, with the LeBlanc being banned, that's one of Kennen's worst matchups. The new Nautilus being locked in, we're going to see that on support again. Maybe the support Vel'Koz, bring it on. We'll see what they have for each other. One last lock in here, a mid laner. What will Slushy take this game? His Orianna has been great. The LeBlanc is banned out, so there's not much there.
Yeah. I want to see what Cali Trolls has for us. Does he go for Convention, or does he go for that AP Gragas again? Thing is, with Team 8, they need to find a way of getting physical damage onto their team. Right now, just having the Graves, if they do magic damage out of the jungle, Lulu, and a magic damage mid laner. What are they going to do with these picks? Vlad is actually a pick Cali Trolls used to play a lot of, and it's good against Maokai. That could be a very real thing.
Reminds me of the old comps Coast used to put together. Old Coast.
Oh, wow.
Kind of like a damage amplification comp.
Yeah.
But we are going to get the Vlad Thresh lock-in.
Heavy magic damage makes stacking MR
heavy.
Fairly easy against these guys, especially against a tank team. Could be really interesting. Mm-hmm. For Cloud9, though, they're another team that I wonder what type of damage they're going to build in this mid lane, because they have a lot of crowd control right here. Really heavy emphasis for the enemy team to build Mercury Treads. So do they build physical damage to try and punish that?
And then get...
Or do we see the return of Talon from high?
Oh.
You never know. Talon, Yasuo, mid lane Ezreal, because they have a good tank line. Or do they just go with Kennen for huge amounts of lockdown?
Hit the Fizz again. If Fizz doesn't necessarily take this team out. Kennen's pretty good pick against this. Corki can still go in the mid lane. I was looking at Team 8's past picks, and they also did that with a Corki in the mid lane. But this time it's Cloud9. They're going to lock that in for high. It's something it's been his in the past. He's no stranger to this pick.
Yeah. So all kinds of damage in the mid lane. I have a theory that I want to check his runes first to make sure it doesn't happen. All right. He's not going for the AP Corki. I was thinking maybe you would do AP Corki, rush a Luden's Echo, and spam your missiles. I think that's actually a good build. But he decides against it from the looks of it. And they go with double AD.
So Meteos bringing out the Nunu. Really the first time besides that Sejuani he's been on one of these tank junglers. Didn't have too much trouble on the Sej. 0-0-14 came out quite big for the team. Now we'll see what they can do against teammate. 8-7 in the standings, looking to move themselves up. They've done some impressive things as a new team in the LCS.
Yeah, this is going to be an exciting game. And
yeah.
There are a few fireworks coming out of these picks and ban phase. You know, the mid lane Lulu, the Sejuani on the side that's not Cloud9, the Corki from mid lane high, Meteos on a big tank jungler that doesn't do that much damage in Nunu. A lot to play out here.
A lot to play out, and the game's about to get live. So start tweeting hashtag T8win or hashtag C9win to @LOLESports so we can see everybody how the vote is changing and playing out. Vote from home, vote from your phones here. Get your votes in. The teams want your support. And we're about to get ready to get into game number 3 on the day. It is Team 8 versus Cloud 9. Let's get on the Rift.
All right. Doran's Blade early for high, solidifying the fact that he is a normal build Corki. Much to my dismay. It's kind of crazy with what's happening right now. This champ select a couple weeks ago would be absolutely crazy. But now we're just like, okay, Vlad top. That makes sense based on teammates' style.
Yeah.
All right, Corki mid, sure. It's just so much experimentation is being embraced by these guys. Love it.
I think everything works with teammates' style once they show it to us. It's like, as I was talking to Slushy yesterday, yeah, Cali Trolls does have a big champion pool, but they are all put through a test. There needs to be a test mode, and then we can play it. Even Sneaky was saying, not sure about what my support is going to do. If he picks Nautilus, what does he do here or there? And in that sense, he's considering what kind of damage is being dealt, you know, through all the abilities, especially at level 3. Is that an all-in? What can you do?
And how much crowd control they're going to have overall.
Right, right.
Just in a team composition perspective, I'm seeing this as a heavily, heavily supportive double AD composition.
Mm-hmm.
They come in all shapes and sizes, for sure. This one has pretty differentiated damage. Sneaky amounts of magic damage shut in, pushed into this one, so stacking armor won't give them absolute immunity against them. However, this Cloud9 team, has very poor backline threat. If they end up falling behind, a strong frontline of Vladimir, Sejuani, backed up by Lulu, could just steamroll the Cloud9 team right here. Or is it just going to be level one? Is this a bait from Lemon? He's just one man. They just let him. They assume he has backup.
He throws out the Riptide and will be safe. No problems there for Lemon, but they know the invasion is down towards the red. They're going to start it still. With the ward there. We'll see if they dip up. You can see they can't afford to lose the CS, knowing this is happening.
I'm going to go ahead.
Yeah, so they stop.
Blue, or red,
they stop teammate from taking any camps early.
Yeah.
Now the real question will be, how does Meteos do the rest of his jungle pathing? Red buffs to Raptors is not something you normally see. Also, Balls didn't start a camp on Maokai. Mm-hmm. Something you would normally see. Because Vladimir can push the wave so quickly, I feel like, if he just starts E, that Maokai could end up being at a disadvantage for that.
Yeah, he definitely started Tides of Blood, trying to get a big push on the lane. Auto attack has caused him a bit of minion damage. That's what you're seeing. But now with level 2 and the transfusion coming out, this is going to be tough for Balls in the lane. He's matched up against 2v1s, but I'm sure Cali Trolls is not going to give him any lax time in that lane.
I really want to see if Cali Trolls can take advantage of Maokai in that lane. The amount of damage that Vladimir can put out in a sustained fashion, as well as a sustain in the lane he has against people that don't have a lot of damage threat like a Maokai, can just completely take over. And Cali Trolls knows that what he was against, and this is kind of the first time we get to see him unleash one of his old classic picks.
It's great to see players on their comforts. It's when you get those style plays. Maybe we'll get that out of Cali Trolls. Porpoise low in the jungle. He will be fine, but we won't see him come into lane anytime soon. You can see Meteos very, very healthy as he makes his way through, going for Raptor clear now.
Meteos did manage to do red to red. Mm-hmm. So a successful three buff there by Meteos. But because he did that, he spent a lot of time just covering ground. Because if we look at the actual gold disparity on the junglers right now, Porpoise just back, Meteos still jungling. Porpoise isn't actually behind, he just doesn't have a red buff. So all he's done with that three buff start, in essence, since the small camps will respawn for Porpoise, is diminish any early ganking that Porpoise would do and completely pushing him into a farm.
And Sejuani is not a gigantic early ganker anyways. Can get it off.
Yeah.
So he's just kind of...
It's a nice move, but it's not one of those, right. Oh man, they totally took Sejuani out of the game because she didn't get red.
GG AFK.
It'll be fine.
That's how it works. Slight gold lead just in the CS. 16 to the jungle, 31 to 23 in mid. But where's the real difference going to start coming from? Lemonation with a forward ward here is sitting in the dark. Maybe a hook. You see Sneaky start to hover that side as well, but they back off. Just trying to add a little bit of pressure in the mind game. 29 to 29 in this lane, but Maple Street has had to chug his potion already, so a bit of aggression by Cloud9 could happen again.
Yep. Got to keep track of Meteos' counter-jungling, whether or not he can stop Porpoise from becoming that team fight beast, or whether or not Cloud9 can stack enough magic resistance against a heavily magic damage team. This could be one of those double or triple Aegis games.
You mean no frozen hearts?
No Banner of Command Scion this time, unfortunately.
Yeah.
That actually did happen in the LCK. The GE Tigers played mid lane Scion against a triple, basically 4 AP comp. It was 3 APs and a 4 key, I believe. So everyone just took magic resistance.
What would be the most annoying thing?
Yeah.
A Banner of Command minion. 5.5 into this one. Both teams, good respect around the map. Meteos has not tried to activate anything off those ganks. He just knows he's kind of hit Porpoise where the red counts. And this ward is actually going to give all the knowledge they need in the bottom lane to stay safe as well. So it gives Cloud9 a little bit of time to keep playing safe and calculate something else. Low man onto Balls here, but he decides to go in for the fight. Cali Trolls, without being level 9 yet for Vlad, still has very high cooldowns. And he cannot get back the health that he needs.
Critical thing for Maokai's in lane, make sure that you are using your auto attack. The passives generate so quickly off of spell cast, and Vladimir pretty much never stops casting spells. So as long as Balls maintains his auto attacking here, he can at least keep up with Vladimir for now. But Kali Troll slowly getting his health back. Of course, Balls did an early recall to get that second Doran's Ring, which is what's giving him that combat effectiveness against Vladimir right now. When Kali Troll goes back to shop again, I feel like Vladimir would start to be able to bully the Maokai yet again.
Hideous using that vision in the bottom lane to keep getting at Porpoise's jungle, and he's out just by a hair on that one. Porpoise is going to find nothing here as he makes his way to the top side.
It's important that Medios keeps up the pressure on that Sejuani. Mm-hmm. Although Porpoise, honestly, is still farming pretty efficiently. Got a Sightstone already. His lanes haven't suffered while he's been farming on Sej, but he himself is a little bit behind it.
That's another good thing as well. Everybody knows that his jungle got hit, so they are playing safe. Teammates, a team that has, obviously, Team 8, they're good teammates. They know what to do.
Sure.
There's a hit onto Dodo. Nautilus passive won't be able to proc anytime soon. They decide not to go right for it.
Cloud9 trying really heavy jungle denial on Porpoise. They know when his red is respawning, and high, wrecking Slushy with that Corki.
Oh, he baited him in, though, just for the Porpoise. I don't know if there's going to be enough damage, really, just to get the counterattack in.
Burn everything from Slushy in the mid lane. No flash, no ult. High doesn't burn a thing. Porpoise had to jump over the wall, as well as forfeit his red buff there.
Where's the rotation in? High is starting to creep down. Porpoise knows he needs to leave. He had vision in the minions there of High. But great harass.
Wow.
That red was already taken.
If Cloud9 wants to, they can go straight for the blue buff as well of teammate. This is some heavy counter jungling that they're going to be putting down onto Porpoise.
And teammate already pinged their blue. Hopefully Slushy can go over,
shop.
But he's going to miss an entire wave if he
High does. Is just sitting on a Sheen, though, and Kali Trolls is chopped, so he might be a little bit stronger than Balls. This is a contentious invade. Cloud9 would love to do it. Porpoise is still low. He didn't have time to go shop here. This is Cloud9's to take. Great job.
Balls as well rotates down on a good push towards Kali Troll's lane. He does clear it. This is going to be a pinch, but I don't know if Kali can actually take this.
Ooh.
3v1. They turn on him. Hemo Plague already from a level 6 top lane. Glacial Prison as well from Porpoise. He's kept himself leveled. Is this all enough, though? They hardly have any damage coming out this early in the game, so it's really just each other scratching their backs, trying to get out of the fight now. Porpoise with the flash in. Zero mana to continue in permafrosted the team, but they're trying to continue the
Dodo's
fight.
There!
There's the hook from Dodo. Is it finally enough? Everybody is just clawing at each other, and the glitter. The glitter is finally the thing to take down Balls.
How did Dodo make it up there through the speed shrine? The extended chase. Eventually, teammate punishes Cloud9 for taking the buffs. Currently, the red-blue buff count is 5 for Cloud9, 1 for teammate. And the other two are going to be respawning on Cloud9's side. So as far as that type of control, it's heavily in Cloud9. But small camps give a lot of gold. First Blood gives a lot of gold. And the gold lead is in the favor of Team 8.
What a skirmish that was. Team 8 throwing all of the resources towards that top lane. So that was Balls going down. He should still be fine. That teleport was used to get back to top lane. So a possible play to be made within that window. We'll see a back from Kali Trolls in the top. So with Cloud9 returning to lanes now, they do know Slushy's Flash is down. So they're trying to work on that just a little bit.
Yeah, Medios really aggressive. What? I mean, he knows Porpoise's ultimate is down on Sejuani.
Yeah, too.
And he knows he doesn't have any buffs because he took them both. Yeah, Cloud9 trying to keep the pressure up with this Nunu.
Slushy took a lot of just free damage in that situation. Not helping these guys in the mid lane. I'm sure he doesn't have any intentions of going for a gigantic fight soon, but it's not going to help them. Cloud9 decides to. Another steal. No Raptor camp for Porpoise, so it's going to get harder to even clear wards. They're starting to put the sweepers in the inventory.
Incredibly aggressive counter jungle from Medios, and he's doing something that's actually not very common on jungle Nunu. A lot of times you'll see people get a Sightstone pretty much after their Hunter's Machete, but Medios has gone straight for the Cinderhulk upgrade, so straight up tank stats and clear speed. And instead of littering the map with wards, he is just beating Porpoise to every jungle camp and being a moving, consuming ward on Nunu.
But how do we see him actually get to that point where he knew where Porpoise was, where he knew how to keep...
He's just stayed ahead of him the whole game. Taking his buffs, knowing the timer, guessing where he's going to be, and also taking both, pretty much both Raptor camps on close to cooldown. And Kali Trolls might be doing a little counter jungling of his own, trying even out this buff counter.
says, I got you, bro. If you can't get it, I will take it. I don't know if he's going to get it safely here. He's going to get the red. He's going to have a difficult time getting out. Cloud9's going to go ahead and put a stamp on the first dragon in this game. Looks like it's going to be a rotation down from balls without that teleport. No, he's just warden.
Cali Trolls has taken to jungling in the top lane.
No. Another attempt. Glacial Prison is up, but Slushi still low on HP and mana. Not able to do anything on this. So we see teammate is still trying to get themselves these picks and do what they can, but the times are not sinking for the players involved in these situations.
Actually, for all the talk we've done about Meteos' counter-jungling Nunu, teammate has done a tremendous job sticking in this game. Calatrol's Vladimir farming well. Bottom lane has been trading very even. You know, we talk about how Maple Street doesn't do anything tremendous, but he usually sticks around. Death here.
Oh, Death Charge! Not going to need it. Put the spotlight on him, and then he goes down, unfortunately. Again, the Raptor camp stolen away. Doesn't even look like Corpus got the smite on that one for himself.
I'm sorry, Maple Street. If I hadn't mentioned it, you'd be alive.
Caster curse.
Finally, Sneaky and Lemon Nation get that Nautilus hook into just a full combo. The CC chain was ridiculous. Dodo could not stop the damage from Sneaky. And yeah, 2v2 lane advantage gained by Cloud9. That's pretty much the main advantage Cloud9 has in this game now.
Again, they get Vision of Porpoise. That's going to make Meteos' job a little bit easier. But he is backing. We'll see what they decide. Cali Trolls on that Hex. Trying to get himself built up. Get that Will of the Ancients and keep
his health. He's really bullying balls now. The turret hasn't died and the CS is still kind of close. But Cali Trolls took two jungle camps from Cloud9 while balls was still in lane. He is effectively ignoring the Maokai in that lane now. And that Vladimir is just going to continue to free farm.
Yep.
The interesting thing about Vladimir is he does so much almost drain tanking in fights because he heals himself with all his spells, especially when he goes spell vamp, that in order to gank him, you would actually need a high damage jungler or a high damage laner. Cloud9 has neither of those things. So even if Meteos goes up to the top lane, it most likely won't matter.
Yep.
There's nothing to stop Cali Trolls from farming here. Cloud9 has to win the rest of the map.
There's a flash. Maple Street is not going to be in any danger in that situation. Yet still looking at balls in the top lane, as we were just talking about. He's quite far off a Rod of Ages that he's trying to build up here. Or rather, if that goes into maybe a Righteous Glory. But his items, he's only sitting on about 800 gold right now. So pretty stuck there. The team's trying to do work on the other side of the map. Maybe get him some global gold in this situation. Awesome turrets. Get that spike in. Dodo, with himself being kept alive, blew his flash, and you can see they have to give respect to this power of Cloud9 at the bottom turret. It was even a roam down from high if things got messy.
Yeah, I think we're in for a really fascinating game here. I think Calatros is going to be a split-pushing Vladimir.
Okay.
And I don't know if Cloud9 has the ways to deal with that outside of brute-forcing down turrets while Vladimir is off split-pushing. Maybe some home guard teleports from balls to make initiations. But it's kind of on Cloud9 to make things happen there, because they really have no one to deal with Cali Trolls conceptually.
See how this fight goes.
Yeah.
Damage trade is pretty even overall to begin this one out. Looks like Balls actually has control of this so far. Twisted Advance, he's just looking for the Maelstrom damage that he was returning.
Here's the problem with that fight. He took Cali Trolls to half health. It cost his entire mana pool. Cali Trolls is probably going to be full health by the time the next wave is dead.
Easy peasy. Just get that level 5 transfusion. You're hitting it very, very often, and you get right back to HP. So, and he's also pushing the lane very fast. We talked about that split push aspect that's going to come into play. It's going to be hard for anybody to stop him, and right now it's going to be hard for Balls to stay alive. He's got the ward, but he's got to back off soon.
Yeah, interesting move here. Balls getting dove.
That looks like it's going to be enough. Hemoplague damage. Giving a little bit of amplification to everybody, and that's Cali Trolls getting the kill, and that's good for him. 101.
Working around Cali Trolls, we're finally seeing some of his pocket picks create positive pressure for the team here in the LCS. Cloud9 needs to press harder on the other avenues of the map because that top lane is lost.
It took a bit. They had to round it out. Cali was also sometimes the problem these guys had going into a fight. Woo. Dodo with the save there.
He almost dashed over the lantern. Yeah, they need some help down here.
A little hook.
Running out of minions. Sneaky running out of mana.
Should be good for now. A good hold here on high in the mid lane by Slushy, keeping that lane pushed in. The solo lanes here are doing a great job at pressuring Cloud9. They could not be available for this bottom lane pressure. They don't get the turret. Not so much wasted time. They just didn't get anything out of it. And teammate with a 200, 300 gold lead. Just kind of hanging in. Nice job. I wouldn't say hanging in, actually. They're making moves.
They really are. Cali Trolls is sitting on 3,000 gold. So
man.
Half of the gold he has made in this game, he is currently sitting unspent in his inventory. I would suggest Cali Trolls shop immediately, and then he can start bullying that lane much harder.
And look at that, a little payback as well. Yeah. Porpoise says, thank you for the blue. I'll take that back. You stole enough of my buffs earlier. So teammate moving up the ward line, making good ground here 17 minutes into the game. We do see the Rod of Ages finally finished up there for Ball, so he'll start to charge up and maybe actually stay away from the fights during this period of time. 30 seconds onto Dragon. Both AD carries are in the bottom lane, so we should expect them to be there as well.
All the pressure is on High and Sneaky to get incredibly farmed this game. I'm skeptical of their ability to win these team fights if Porpoise continues to farm at a decent pace. Like, Cloud9, you could see how heavily Meteos was trying to shut down Porpoise because he knows that if Vlad and Sejuani both get farmed, Cloud9 will lose because they don't have backline threat and they need to be able to cut through the tanks like paper. Luckily, Porpoise was forced into a sightstone, so he's a little bit weak now. Yeah. I feel like Cloud9 needs to win these fights before the tanks can get Rand wins or Frozen Hearts completed.
Right.
In the hyper late game, maybe Cloud9 can cut through them again, but that's just too far away.
They're also not working.
Really tricky. And Cali Trolls is in this fight right now. They do not want to deal with the Vladimir who just spent all 3,000 of his gold on completing his items.
Slushy with the shield. He stays safe. You're also looking at, they kind of, with the composition that they made, have the 80 carries that benefit the least from Nunu's Blood Boil, which is an unfortunate thing. I'm sure they weren't saying, oh man, this is bad, but we still have to pick it.
Well, they got Lucian, itch. I mean, he does have the double shot, can still be a decent hyper carry. It's not as bad as having like two Corkies on your team. It can't be beneficial from the blood boil.
Nothing at all. Corky and a Sivir.
Whoa, big time fight.
Oh, the hook again on the Lemon. Don't know if it's enough to follow. Depth charge pops three, but Lemon Nation gets hit even harder. He is taken down. Sneaky very low. Glass Glitter Lance comes in as Meteos returns a retribution kill there. A good hook may stop the follow up onto Sejuani. And they're able to get out alive, too. It's Sneaky and Lemon going down for Slushy and Cali.
We'll have to see that again with eyes on Cali Trolls because he was off the top of the screen trying to dive so deep there, allowing Cloud9 to equalize this fight.
We just mentioned Cali Trolls sometimes goes a little too deep. He had remedied that the past few weeks, but you may see a bit of the tendency there again.
Yeah, a very equal fight ends up coming out of that one when it looked like teammates should have had the edge. I mean, watch this one. They're trying to clear the way with the culling. And Cali Trolls, like, he's taking a turret shot when he flashes in to go onto the turret. Like, there's no escape from that. And then they don't even finish the turret off because they're so distracted by the fight. Live and die by the whims of Cali Trolls. He was doing so well on Vladimir earlier. Makes a misplay there under the turret to trade some kills.
Doesn't look like they want to give up pressure just yet. So that was a mistake. We'll avoid that and just go for the turret this time.
Yes.
Good choice. You're going to go ahead and just take this one down textbook style. Maokai pushing the top lane, so somebody's going to have to answer to that quite soon here as Sneaky also getting a push on the bottom. Looks like we're going to get Azania's next up for Cali Trolls here so he can be a bit more of a menace and go invulnerable twice in these fights. So I guess you should say untargetable and invulnerable. Still kill him in blood. In the pool. Seeing another Zhonya's that will be coming from Slushy. These guys building up. He's done pretty good in the mid lane. Not on his LeBlanc or Orianna here. 2-1-1. So he's faring quite well. A little bit down in CS though.
We'll have to wait and see how that transitions into these mid-game team fights. Lulu always an interesting choice. So versatile, and it's becoming a bit of a siege fight. See, this is the game Cloud9 needs to play. There's a Vladimir off in the top lane. Cloud9 immediately needs to pressure the mid lane where Vladimir is not, because there is no one they can send for that Vlad without sending pretty much the whole team.
Well, they have fantastic wave clear here with Buckshot going into the Glitter Lance. Will it be enough, though, with the brute force of the team? Porpoise, no initiation there. Lemon standing off on the side. Remember, Cali Trolls is getting good pressure right now in the top lane with his push.
Yeah.
And the mid turret is not taken down by Cloud9. Not the best turret takedown guy, but he's there. doing what he can.
It's going to be a push and pull. This is a much closer game than Cloud9 would have liked. I mean, remember, with the loss COG just had to TSM, a win here for Cloud9 ties them for second place. But Team 8, if they win this game, are actually within one game of Cloud9. They're really making a late season surge here, and they need these games to clinch their playoff spot.
That is crazy to think about.
How close this league really could become with a few games falling into slightly upset, focused waters. Team 8, I feel like, is putting themselves in position to win this one, despite the gold being so close right now. In fact, they have the Sejuani, the unstoppable Vladimir in that lane, and maybe a Lulu to help shield the tanks that Cloud9's double AD carry composition might not have the damage to take down. Let's see, though, if Cloud9 can find the right fights.
Definitely interesting compositions to watch fight because both of them kind of want to ball together with those AoE ultimates down. The jungle provides their advantages to those fights for both teams as well. It's going to be great. Still watching for Cali to come up big on that damage. Still waiting to see Cloud9 build up the inventories to break through this tank line. Sejuani's starting to get there. Porpoise with the Giant's Belt now as they lose their mid turret. Can't do much on that. They knew it was going to go down.
Yeah, this is...
Maple Street's low as well. I don't know why we're getting to teleport in on this one. It could be very scary. It's just Cali Trolls slowing down.
Teammate didn't want to lose both of their mid lane turrets, but they just got out-rotated like crazy right there. Cali Trolls was off in the top lane, not creating turret pressure. So Cloud9 never had to send a responder while Teammate was backing. That was just poor communication across the board, and they are trying to get something back here. But because of the teleport in from Cali Trolls, I think that was also a teleport in straight from the lane. So he hasn't even shot yet. Not efficient play.
He's still sitting on all that.
1,600 gold now. So he very close to completing his Zhonya's.
Yep. So that teleport being down means he can't easily add pressure to the top lane. Cloud9 may be able to force something they want to do and start to dictate this game to the beat of their own drum. 2,000 gold in the lead. They have taken that away from Teammate and started to spread it out a little bit. Dragon is up at 30 seconds. They've gotten Raptor. Fortunately, it was cleared out by a close ward for Meteos. So hopefully they have enough to do it as well at Dragon. Teammate is already surrounding that area. Teleports up for balls. He'll be able to get here in time. Almost the catch onto Slushy. Lemonation couldn't grapevine well enough, though. Too many minions.
Big time fan support coming from Cloud9 as well.
Yep.
Still very interested to see how those double AD carries work in the team fight. Vladimir can be quite weak to heavy sustained damage. If they can burst it quickly with Lucian and Corki, who are very spell-based AD carries, so maybe they'd have the windows to take him down. And the rotational game by Cloud9 is wrecking Teammate right now. Teammate's the one. They're the team that have the guy that no one can deal with, yet Cloud9 is winning this around the map. Very good strategic play by them right now. Almost forcing Teammate into an initiation, but Sejuani has to lead the way.
This could be it. The Cali call's coming out, and they miss balls on the hook, unfortunately. Porpoise Pops coming out, ready to fight now with a Warmox on the Sejuani, so he can just be a complete beast. High looks to solo out Maple Street here in the mid lane.
Trinity Force Power Spike as well as Sork Shoes and a large amount of physical damage. That is the Corki time in the game when he is at his most powerful.
Got to make an impact. Ooh, they are also getting themselves into situations that could backfire, but...
I love how Cloud9 is adapting to this. They're keeping AD carries on two different spots, so one of them would be able to deal with Vladimir, and it's really splitting Teammate up. They have no split push pressure, now they're forced to fight.
Depth charge goes out. That might have stopped Porpoise from throwing out that Glacial Prison, knowing his team could not follow. And they get a turret and disengage. Teammate is fending things off, but not efficiently.
No, this is really brilliant. We talked about the problem that Cloud9 would have dealing with Vladimir. You can't just have your jungler and top laner do that because no one's a damage dealer. So what they're doing is they're pairing up each AD carry with a tank so that there's CC for the damage dealer, and it's shutting down the split push of Teammate.
See Teammate once again back towards the mid lane. Can they do this fast enough? It seems like Cloud9 has routed them twice here as they try to get to the mid.
It's five turrets to two. That's how heavily Cloud9 has been out pushing them.
And they don't even have the wave to get there. C9 may actually be able to...
There's no teleport on Cali Trolls either.
To base
basically,
and
Teammate has to dive here.
Well, it looks like Cali Trolls tried to. That was unnecessary as they got the turret and they had the ability to do so without a fight. Looks like Meteos from the side. It's going to be able to slow Slushy. TP coming in. Balls is now with this one. Does he have anybody? He goes for Slushy. That's going to be the lockdown, but the Wild Growth is there to save. Kali Troll's coming in from the side, but he has to stay outside. Absolute Zero. Great hit by Meteos there to keep everybody zoned. And the fight goes on and on. These guys are so tanky, but Cloud9 finally finding a way through the armor. Three drop almost immediately. Now eyes on to Slushy. High's low on mana. The missiles. No, he had it charged in. And he hits it. Eagle Eye high on the long shot. 7-4 here, 27 minutes in.
Just excellent play by Cloud9. They completely shut down what teammate thought was their strength in this one. And they end up forcing teammate into the fight that Cloud9 actually wanted to get in the mid game. Before Sejuani has built armor, before Vladimir is absolutely super powered, and before Maple Street can benefit hugely from a help pick spike. Plus they get the flank. Like, everything about this fight was beautiful for Cloud9. So first off, teammate had just dove, so they were down a lot of health. Balls comes around the backside, and Kali Trolls is already low. So as far as battle lines being concerned, Cloud9 had the freedom to be able to kind of hit whoever they wanted. There's no armor tank on the team yet. Failed flash over the wall only makes matters worse. High, with that little tiny bit of mana, is able to get just enough for a missile. Bullseye right at the end. Plus they get the Baron. Wow. Really turning this game on its head. This is a game Cloud9 was losing, but because of superior map play and some really smart forces, they're up 7K.
Continued to keep the pressure on. Saw that Meteos didn't really get much out of stealing all the camps of Porpoise, but what they were able to do after that and find teammate trying to get back into the game was really what gave Cloud9 their lead. Pushing all the lanes now, like you said, keeping the AD carries on different turrets, different positionings rather, all the time to make sure they can get the turrets they need and the positioning they need. So looking at what items are coming out here. Porpoise has slowed down a little bit after that Warmogs. Quite a bit of money to put into an item. And I don't know if it's keeping them alive.
Here's the other problem, too, now. Since Cloud9 has been able to pull ahead, they've been able to actually stack magic resistance. Spirit Visage, a second Spectre's Cowl, and Mercury Treads onto the Maokai. Actually able to kind of duel Kali Trolls a little bit.
Yeah.
Since Kali Trolls has no magic pen as of yet, needs that void stack.
Very methodical by Cloud9. Not seeing any of those things that plague them at IEM here. Keeping composed, even if things aren't working, and really just keeping their head in the game.
No desperation dives at all. Just solid play.
This wave clear, still giving them a little bit of trouble. It takes about two or three goes for Cloud9 to get through a turret, and maybe this could be that chance. A good glacial prison on top of that hemo plague, stacked with the collateral damage. A lot of what-ifs and a lot of skill shot alts you gotta hit.
A lot of what-ifs for teammate in this game in general.
Yeah.
Like, what if they had been able to save their teleports? What if they'd held that mid lane turret? Because once the structure started falling, you could tell teammate kind of started to panic.
Yeah.
Oh, maybe this is the fight for them, though. It's inside their base.
Eye for an eye, a hook for a hook, and Maple Street comes up with that one. Kali Troll's very low, but he's sitting right in the middle with Wild Growth, and he gets absolutely zeroed. That's Porpoise going down as well. The tankiest guy is not good being down that early. That means everybody else has to scatter. Cloud9 feels like they got what they want. Not even that much damage on the turret, but they're able to return.
Huh.
Actually, they leave.
I'm surprised they didn't continue to push down that turret.
Yeah.
I think they would have been able to get it down. But even so, looking at that fight, one thing a Corki and Lucian team wants, especially this Cloud9 team, very little upfront burst damage, so they want extended fights. That's actually what they're getting now against teammate. Mainly because the split pushing isn't happening. You know, they're able to hold their front line. We talked about Cloud9 not having backline threat. Well, teammate doesn't have backline threat either because Kali Trolls can't flank from inside his own base. Let's use the base gate, which he's not doing. He ends up trying to flash just to get onto Lucian. It's a quick dash away. Some de-synergy with the Lulu ultimate happening right as he Zhonya's. That allows Meteos to prep the Nunu ultimate, confirming Kali Trolls' fate. Too many flash ins from Vladimir this game.
Thought they had a move on Righteous Glory. There was quite a bit of focus on Lemonation in that fight to take down. It's a big tank on that Nautilus support.
Yeah.
Cali Trolls on the back line, so miscommunication in a few areas for teammate within that fight. Holding at their base now. Cloud9 just focusing on that with balls in the top lane here. They're not afraid to push out. They're trying to play some of these wards, but Cloud9 is also getting more and more chances to get an initiation if they want it. 5 seconds on a dragon.
Yep. They'll just wait on the dragon.
Yep.
Cloud9 is actually able to get to that point now where their AD carries will be able to cut through tanks, even if the tanks build armor. Yet, Porpoise still isn't building armor. He just has some Ninja Tabi. Yet, we got Last Whispers on Sneaky. He's probably working on a Bloodthirster soon. I feel like we have an Infinity Edge shortly onto Hyze and Porky. Things are looking very grim for teammate. That's what happens when you're 9,000 gold behind.
Just keeps excelling. High doing more and more damage. Bloodthirster into another BF. Looking for an Infinity Edge on the end of that. He is going to be in the mid lane by himself right now. The team split and just gathering what they can. Cloud9 always sure of what they want to do at the time. Nobody's trying to go crazy. Nobody's doing something that's going to throw the game out of whack. Teammate is not going to be able to pick up any of these solo kills. And they don't even have that much vision on the side of Cloud9. Still playing the game somehow the way they can do it. Getting every kill they need, 9-5. And now a 9,000 gold lead. Especially 30 minutes in, that's quite a gold lead to have. Biding time until that next fight, chat. 1 minute on to Baron. I'm not sure teammate will even be able to really approach that.
Mm-hmm. I think you're absolutely right there. Even the few wards they've been able to scout into the river were just removed. Medios has had control over that Raptor buff for so much of this game on top of his upgraded sweeper. Mm-hmm. So very, very big time ward clearing methods. Cali Trolls really wants to get that side lane rolling. I feel like he can actually get a turret off of this if he goes for it. It'll definitely mean Cloud9 gets the Baron though. It's honestly a trade that's probably worth it because I don't think teammate can contest that Baron regardless. Maple Street, though, actually gets caught out a little bit. This is the damage from balls.
A little bit of help from Porpoise. That's a Righteous Glory. There is the Randuin's effect after as you're chasing down your opponents, and they are going hard. Cali Trolls pushing in the bottom lane here. Like we said, those turrets aren't going to go down fast from him, but he is trying to create some amount of pressure here to let the team breathe. As they defend the base, his teleport comes into the turret. He may be the focus though. Throws down the Hemo Plague immediately. Glacial Prison has already been used and is not gonna be much follow-up damage on the Hemo Plague advance. They're going down. They're really low. I was waiting for a triple or a quadra kill to instantly come up there in that pause, but Cloud9 instantly disengages and go back in for Maple. The snowball, not enough. And they get out. Cali Trolls coming back in. Will he get a nice Tides of Blood? Transfusion hits. Sanguine Pool is out. It's just everybody. Sliver of health every time. It was only Sneaky that went down, and somehow Cloud9 get out with the turret and the inhibitor.
That is the best fight teammate is going to find for the remainder of this game. Everything fell in their favor as far as what needs to happen for them to win a fight. Cloud9 was engaged on an active turret while Cali Trolls teleported in, and he got the ultimate onto the back line. They interrupted the Nunu ultimate in the midst of all that, and they still just trade the fight. They're out of options. Desperation mode for teammate. They're going for Baron because they know Cloud9 is low and backing.
Oh, also the teleport in, actually. Home guards right into it, making sure somebody is still goal side to him with Baron, so they're taking the damage, but it was more or less him. He could go down here before the team can help. Gets one last heal off of that passive,
back
but
on a Baron.
Teammate,
keep forcing
they
him in again
do not
again.
Want to stop. Medios very low, and they should. They should keep forcing it. Teammate making the right call. High, he's going to go down. He tries to fight valiantly, doing as much damage
Fuck
as he can. Sneaky's going to get hit. He just spawned, and now he's back down. A double kill for Cali, and Team 8 pull the trigger to put Cloud9 on the ropes. There's still 6,000 gold down, though.
There's a reason teams run to Baron in points of desperation, because sometimes it works. And in this case, Cloud9 was just low enough. Dodo landed enough hooks, and Cloud9 was desperate enough in their opposition of the Desperation Baron that play finally works out. Oh man, this makes this game so much more interesting. I mean, first off, Baron's at 7,000 health. when Balls decides to jump in against four people. You can wait a little while because Cloud9 is waiting on people from the base this entire time. Imagine a world where this fight starts and Sneaky is actually there. So now High gets hooked. He goes down pretty much before anyone else is able to get there. Meteos, now Sneaky's here. That's great.
Oh.
But it's right when Dodo's hook is back up.
He got a pie to the face as Meteos steps aside there.
I mean, huge credit for Dodo for making that play happen. Huge credit for teammate for focusing the right targets and not trying to finish the Baron. But man, Cloud9 panicked when teammate started the Baron.
And that's something to mention just in a situation like that overall is panic, especially when you're down. Somewhat, maybe even second-guessing a lot of your calls is that they stayed composed in one of the most intense moments you can have in a league match. So seeing teammate do that here with their backs against the rope so far down, definitely a little bit of hope at the end of the tunnel here for this game. Cloud9 still not going to make it easy for them and are right back on the side of teammate's map.
Interesting that Maple Street's going for Blade of the Ruined King as his lifesteal item instead of Bloodthirster. There are a lot of really high health targets that he needs to cut through in this game. And remember how we talked about Cloud9 not having much backline threat, meaning the AD carries aren't really hitting Maple Street, so the shield isn't as important. I actually like that choice. And teammate trying to force with his Baron buff. This will be interesting.
This is a great fight for Team A right now. Lemonation and Balls can get dropped immediately. Nobody can really touch Kali Trolls on the other side. Ultimate coming in. That's the calling from Lucian. It doesn't even touch the brick wall that is Kali and Porpoise. And they get out with two more clean kills.
Remember when I said the inhibitor fight was the best fight? Teammate's going to find this fight. I was very wrong because I did not expect that Baron to turn things around. In that instant, it was the proper fight. They isolate Cloud9's tanks where no one can take damage, but more importantly, Kali Trolls' Vladimir had the zoning flank. He was around the top of that corridor, keeping High and Sneaky from entering that fight, which gave time for teammate to finish off those tanks. This could very well be going teammate's way, if you can believe it.
They made the right moves after the fact. They got pushed in very hard in the beginning of this game. They have a giant wave in the bottom to work with here in a few minutes, as now they can actually take a breather and feel quite proud of themselves for the past few minutes of the game. They have brought it back. As that Baron fight happened, like I said, they were down 6,000 gold. It's now 64,000 to 63,000, and those items are being finished. You said that Maple Street was on the way to that Blade of the Rune King. He pretty much just bought it already.
Yeah, and there's another reason I like it,
too. Such a surge.
If he's getting the picks from Lulu, it gives him more attack speed to try and benefit that as
amplified.
Well.
Amplified. Not amplified, but more damage.
Oh, yeah. Much more damage. This is teammate making that desperation Baron call. I mean, the fight that Cloud9 took on the doorstep of teammate's base was very sloppy. They thought they got away with it. And now Cloud9 actually kind of has to get picks. That was Righteous Glory.
Yep.
So. Got a flash down on a Dodo, which is nice, but the counter initiation lands it. It's a little bit slow on the follow, though.
Cleanse from Sneaky on the back line. Again, the culling doesn't do much damage through it. High is now able to shred from the outside, and the Gatling's hitting quite well. Can they finish it, though? Sneaky picks up one. Eyes onto Maple Street.
Maple's
he gets wild,
this.
Goes it out. If Maple can get back in, though, he is so slowed, and the Cloud9 team is able to back up during that period of time.
You saw there, Cloud9 tried pretty desperately to get onto Maple Street, and they didn't even come close. Both High and Sneaky came around from the flank. And then, oh wow, clever play by High. He is cutting the Minion wave.
Yep.
So the minions do not arrive in that turret. I wonder if teammate even gets this.
And he's also going to go for the inhibitor on the bottom side of the map.
Oh, so clever.
Right over the base gate, and he's going to start putting damage down. Now the follow-in from Sneaky, maybe stopping some backs, but he doesn't want to go too far. A huge wave in the bottom that teammate's not going to be able to act on, and that's going to be cleared out, and Cloud9 made great work of this situation.
What a back-and-forth game. Definite mistakes throughout, but this is nothing if it's not entertaining because there is so much on the line for these guys right now. Cloud9 needing to get that win to tie themselves to CLG for second place in the LCS, and teammate fighting for those last playoff spots here, not wanting to drop to seventh.
Hold it for me, bro. Yeah, oh, he shot that one. There you go. There's a little bromant between Sneaky and Lemon. Let's see this again. What an initiation, and then everything else after.
There's only a few damage dealers on Cloud9 here. It's the Lucian and the Corki. Lucian tries to flank around the box just to get to Maple Street. He's the real threat right here. Both High and Sneaky try and go for him, but honestly, they just can't get to him. He flashes away while he has a Lulu ult. if Maple Street hadn't flashed back, I actually think they clean up that fight because he didn't realize how well protected he actually was from all the chaos coming at him.
That's a little bit of that communication. We saw the Zhonya's on the Lulu ult earlier. We saw the flash out on the Lulu ult there. It's a very, very hectic moment, but those calls do need to be made throughout the team. 15 to 14, we got a barn burner on our hands now. 60, just creeping up on 70,000 to 68,000. Dragon is 3-2. He's gonna get it, don't worry. So, some wards now to be placed. Both teams have lost a bit of vision over this time of just pretty much 5-on-5 fights once they get that back up. You see a little bit more coordination out of these guys with flanks. Pretty much core items that need to be finished are finished now. They're adding in extra bag of chips.
I'm actually really curious to see if Maple Street goes for another offensive item, if he does Bloodthirster last item, just for even more damage. Only because he needs to be the one to cut through the tank line here. Mm-hmm. And he's already doing a good job of it. He can be an even better job. I think he's fairly well protected from high and sneaky. Yeah, and he goes BF Sword. He's going Bloodthirster final item. Yep. Smart build by Maple Street throughout the game.
We mentioned it a little bit earlier, too. Is he's not the one kind of being a super bright spot and 1v1ing everyone, but he is positioning right in the benefactor of these fights now. 7-1 and 5, kind of out of nowhere. And he's going to be even bigger once he gets that Bloodthirster.
Teammates also had a game sneakily similar to this earlier in the year against Team Impulse. If we think back, Team Impulse was running a double AD comp, had lost early, came back heavily in the game, and there was a decisive fight at Baron where Maple Street killed both of the enemy AD carries on Team Impulse, and was actually on Graves as well. He's very comfortable playing against two AD carries in these comps, knowing how safe he can be when the other team doesn't have threat on him. Oh no, Sejuani's behind them. Calitros has the flank.
What a sideswipe. They were going in for Slushy. They thought they had it, but it was really just the bait by him. Medio's still tanky. Corpus and Cali are very low to start this one off. That's Lemonation going down, however. A bit of a tank for Cloud9 now.
Close fight.
Slushy
Calitros
is
still
down.
Alive.
We said the jungle fights in these choke points would be big for both teams, but this one stepping up big for Cloud9 as they drop three members of Team 8 here. What can they get out of it, though?
Corpus needs to find a way to heal. It's still a CC tank, two CC tanks, and an AD carry. Team 8 would love to stop this Baron, but they got to be careful not to overcommit. Cloud9 pulls off it. What a close fight we had in that corridor.
Pinging on Dragon. Lane's not too much to be pushed here. High's going to gather mid lane. So we can still see Cloud9 can assess these fights well enough to take it into their favor. We'll see how this exactly happens.
So this one, it looked like teammate had the initiation on because Porpoise got sneaky at Meteos, but High is still at the back, and then Meteos gets off a beautiful zoning absolute zero right there. Maple Street cuts through Lemonation really easily, but he can't actually go deeper just because of the way the map is shaped right here without revealing himself to Sneaky's damage. It ends up that everyone just uses their zoning ult, trades them in there, and once again, Calitrolls goes a little bit too deep. If Calitrolls is 5 or 10 feet farther back, then he's in range for Maple Street to do damage, but he was in that spot, and there was no follow-up. Awesome, awesome game.
Has been fantastic play from both teams coming out here. The vote in Cloud9's favor on this one, but the Team 8 fans definitely happy with the results so far.
And Cloud9 is currently sitting on four dragons right now. This game is...
So that's the pressure.
So perfectly illustrating the strengths and weaknesses of double AD carry with a bunch of tanks on it right now. Oh, do they go for Baron again?
We're back to Baron.
Just showing, but he has a
teleport right.
They're hoping that Cloud9 funnels in and loses their battle lines. I feel like they're just trying to get a repeat of last fight here, and they don't get it.
How much do they want that, right? You grab the tank. Hide a solo. Calitrolls here for a second, knowing the back line's there. Maple Street, takes a bit of damage after the depth charge. They got exactly what they wanted there, but not enough is following Maple Street as well, so now he's safe. It could be the turnaround. There it is, High and Porpoise going 1v1. That's going to be balls going down. Dodo's already fallen, but he used everything and offered all the help that he could. It was enough for the team to stay alive. It was enough for teammate to persevere.
Maple Street against the world here with all the protection. It looked like he was going down, but he's got so much damage right now. The elixir he has to help his lifesteal.
Oh, dear.
He is crushing him now. Lemonation, what are you doing?
Kill him. Kill him. Go.
He's dead.
Fire the glitter.
Ah!
Yes.
Now Maple Street right now. Cali Trolls trying to help him out.
Okay, so they should be able to have the damage here. They have the tank stats to get through this turret. And Team 8 turns the game on its head. 40-second timers on the clock. This
Look,
could be the
it.
Nexus turret if Meteos can't do anything.
Oh, my God.
Oh, he's laughing at him.
Slushy
the
with
BM.
The manor right there. Everybody is dead. The minions are here. Team 8 just won.
You got to be kidding me, Jat. What an amazing game coming out here from Team 8. They thwart Cloud9. They put them, turn them on their head and steal their lunch money, as Kobe would say. Team 8 takes down Cloud9.
Maple Street, the American badass right now, raising one shoe to the sky.
One for the homies.
And they take down Cloud9.
What a story of hanging in there for Team 8 in this game. Finding that fight at the inhibitor, like, I completely agree with you. That's the best fight that they were going to find. Cloud9 made some mistakes, but it was just seemed like Team 8 wanted to find the fight again, and they did. That double back and forth on Baron was amazing against Cloud9. That's what got him in.
Team 8 was so heavily on their back foot. Maple Street getting all the high fives.
Oh, and love!
Of course.
All the love.
Hugs all around. And a tough loss for Cloud9, honestly.
Yeah, it was.
They themselves too fought back in this game because they were down. They could not deal with Calitrolls' Vladimir. Cloud9 then rotated around the map beautifully.
Yep.
They went a little bit too deep on one of their dives, didn't even lose the fight, and then panicked at the desperation Baron teammate was going for. From that point, it was then still a close game.
Yeah.
It went back and forth to the point that they were equal.
It was
so rare.
Such a good move by teammate to go for that Baron as fast as they did as well. Forced Meteos to stay at half health, a few of the other guys as well. And it was that instance. You know, we see Cloud9 towards the late game start to falter. That teleport in from Balls was so far ahead of everybody else, and the Baron used to like 7,000 health.
Yeah.
They don't have to keep doing it. That was an easy peel off. So great wins there, Jet Lake. You said 9-7 now. For Team 8.
I know.
Kind of crazy.
Them into this week against Winter Fox and Cloud9. I don't think they expected to go 2-0. Next week they play CLG and Gravity. Both of those games are so incredibly critical. They're not clinched yet, but they're in position where a win will clinch the playoffs.
And Gravity's looking really good right now. A team to be reckoned with as well as CLG. You know, they lost to Team Solo Mid, but they're losing just to the top teams in the league. So you're very right about that. And it's amazing to see them doing so well. A lot of these teams would come in and say, you know, we're looking to do really well next split.
Yeah.
It's like, well, you're actually doing really well this split.
Mm-hmm.
So keep it going.
The teams they've taken down TSM. They've taken down Team Impulse, Liquid. Like, they've beaten everyone in the league except for CLG, I feel like. That's probably wrong. I just looked at the stats and I didn't verify it, but it's close to everyone in the game. And Gravity. The two teams they play next week are the teams they haven't beaten yet.
Looking at this as well, the team name just is resounding for them. Teammate. They are teammates. Yes, Slushy will carry a game sometimes, but in the end, it's the entire team being there for the fight, mm-hmm. being in the right position. Whether they made the few communication mistakes or not, they seem to be able to shore them up. And for the inside story on that wild game, let's send it down to Kobe, who's with teammates Shoeless Wonder.
I am here with Maple after an epic win, and your teammate kind of hung you out to dry, threw your shoes into the crowd. Did you get them back?
I'm not sure. I'm just going to troll Slushy in a few games, and that's how I'll get back at him for throwing my shoes at the crowd.
All right, well, that sounds good. There are a lot of changes with the 5.5 patch, and we've seen a lot of different strategies break out. One of the most consistent things, though, is that there are a lot of tanks now. How does that change the life of an AD carry playing on the new patch when a team like Cloud9 runs three tanks?
Yeah, it's kind of annoying, but Graves actually can turn into a bit of hyper carry with Bork. He does a lot of DPS. So I wasn't too concerned. My team ran double AP, and like they couldn't itemize against us really well. And Dodo landed lots of great hooks, and we just had a good game. And AD carry's still fine.
Still fine! Everything is A-OK. Does that make you guys, you know, prioritize more picks like Lulu and things that can protect AD carries more? Or everything's just fine, and you can handle yourself?
We have our own playstyle. Generally, we don't really protect me, and we take all the gold away from me. And Cali and Slushy carry.
take your shoes away from you.
Yeah, I'm going to be no money, no shoes. It's a sad day for me.
But you'll be in the playoffs. You guys are looking like you're heading into the playoffs. You do have CLG and Gravity, both really hard games coming up next week. And Gravity especially is going to be a really big game for you. What are you looking forward to next week?
Yeah, I'm going to try to get my revenge on COG since they stomped us in one of the first games of the season. Gravity also beat us in a really close game, and I'm pretty sure Gravity's our last game, and that will probably decide who is 7th and who is 6th place in the league.
All right, well, congratulations and good luck next week. Now, we are going to send it over to the guys at the Telestrator.
Thank you, Kobe. And really, there are a thousand fights in that game that we could look at. We're only going to get to look at one. And I want to pull it up on the screen immediately. Is that Baron call by teammate, which brought them back into the game? So set this up for me as to, you know, why this was the correct call and the follow through on the plays.
All right. So this is right after, to refresh everybody's memory, the fight that was towards the top inhibitor where Cloud9 actually claimed that inhibitor for themselves, almost got a lot of kills, almost got killed themselves, and then it was just a trail off. Cali goes back, gets home guards, and just pushes them out. They actually continue to push them all the way up to the Baron pit, and Balls is forced to TP back in after backing. But he started his back timer before, right here on the minimap. You can see Lemonation and Meteos are trying to back in the bush, and they're like, oh no, we're making a play off of this because teammate have rushed the Baron. Sneaky is dead at this point. You can see it right there. He's dead. And High is actually back right here. There are only three tanks present that end up at this Baron. They have none of their damage dealers because they're only running 280 carries as a damage source. So what ends up happening, we can start rolling the clip out now, is Balls will come in and he goes hard. He goes immediately in there. He doesn't decide to check it because they have no vision. He's like, I have to go in. And he goes immediately onto Maple Street. But this is what happens is Cali Trolls and Dodo immediately section off the remaining tanks, and they just pick off Balls, focus their DPS on him, and they're already at half HP here from C9 because of the fact that they had been fighting earlier. High goes up to the front and gets hit with a hook. His two tanks that are left are behind him. Nobody's there to back him up.
Yeah, Sneaky's still on the way. Those hooks, as Maple Street rightly pointed out, were pretty essential to the comeback that was made by teammate.
This was just really poor positioning, though, and the fact that C9 had to play with lower HP bars and juggle the situation of do I go in, do I not go in? Balls ran in at 7,000 HP left on it, and another hook by Dodo. That was, I thought Sneaky was going to come in and clean that fight up with his crits. He does end up getting some kills, but the fact that that hook came out, so Dodo is really the MVP of that minor play right there. There's those minor plays, the hook, which turned out to be a huge play because they were 7K down at that point in the game. And the fact right before that, Cloud9 didn't get any kills on them and they got sneaky off of that was what allowed them to get that Baron. So overall, really good just split second decision because they had pressure on them for like 10 minutes before that play happened. And teammate were eventually able to be like, okay, we got by the skin of our teeth. Very lucky that they didn't die. No crits that took them out over at the inhibitor. And then they immediately capitalize off of that and take that little opening and force C9 to kind of panic.
Well, that's the key, right? Is that they made a great in-the-moment decision based on information that they had, which was that Cloud9 is not prepared for a fight if they stay. So they have two choices. Either they back and regen, but seed the Baron, or they fight us now and lose the fight. And as you said, Cloud9, a team that normally has so much foresight into the game and is prepared for these kinds of things, were thrown off kilter. And we saw it in their execution is that they were like, okay, let's make a play off of this, but they funneled in. And then the mechanical play by Dodo there, as you rightly pointed out, just landing those two crucial hooks. Sneaky actually had QSS there. That's the one mechanical thing I could have, as you said, he was maybe in the position to clean that up if he had used his QSS there. It's possible that he decided to he would have rolled through the team. Still unlikely.
Yeah.
But ultimately, I do. I mean, I really believe that, as Jat pointed out as well, this one opening, they seized it, they took it, and it brought them right back into the game. From then, you know, it's still more back and forth. They played it out correctly, though. Fantastic win for them.
Yeah, and also just another part of that pressure that they were applying to Cloud9, it wasn't just low health bars, it was the lack of vision. Balls has to TP onto that ward. That's the only ward that he has in the vicinity because they cleared out the Baron pit. And the fact he has to face check it to even see the HP on it and how quickly it's going down, that's a very quick split second shot calling decision that is like, do we check it? Do we not check it? What is Balls doing? And how do you just get the team to wrap around that situation? And Cloud9 misplayed that fight just in like one or two different ways, and it cost them the game and let teammate back in.
An exciting game, making the standings even closer than they were before. When we return, we'll see if Team Impulse can get some Week 4 revenge when they face off against Winter Fox. You're watching the NA LCS.
Oh, am I now?
Knock, knock. Give us a knock, knock or something.
Knock, knock.
Come on, let's have some fun here.
Give us a knock, knock, or I quit LCS.
Knock,
right now.
Knock.
just walk off the stage. I'm going home.
That's going to be the lockdown, but the Wild Growth is there to save. Kali Troll's coming in from the side, but he has to stay outside. Absolute zero. Now eyes on to Slushy. Highs low on mana. The missiles. No, he had it charged in, and he hits it. Eagle Eye high.
Vlad's rear, though. Vlad's off. Yo, Vlad flashed it. Vlad flashed it. Kill Vlad.
He has Sonya. He has Sonya.
It's okay. Just careful.
I'm dead. I'm dead red.
Hit Vlad. Hit Vlad. Porpoise, Porpoise. He's got no flash.
I guess Lana.
Slump, slump, slump.
Lucian, 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 Lucian.
Woo! Nice.
Nice! 40 second timers on the clock. This could be the Nexus turret if Meteos can't do anything.
Oh my god.
Oh, he's laughing at him. You gotta be kidding me. Team 8 takes down Cloud 9.